So we are all gathered here this time round to contemplate upon the text or the verses written by Jnaneshwar Maharaj to Changdev Maharaj, and they are called the Changdev Pasashti. So what is this text? This text, who is the, as I already told you, it is written by Jnaneshwar Maharaj. It was written to Changdev Maharaj. The content of this text is Vedanta. It's Chidvilas. It's to recognize that you are essentially all that there is. Nothing else exists in this creation other than the conscious principle. That is the subject matter of this text. So why did we name it as Love Letter to a Yogi? That will come to. So before we come to this point, why this letter was written, let's see a little bit about the life of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. Many of you, some of you who have been attending Amrut Anubhav, that was started I think 5-6 years ago, and that time we told the story of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. I'm sure you have forgotten it, so I can repeat it again. Jnaneshwar Maharaj, just now we chanted Jnaneshwar, Jnaneshwara Mauli Jnanadev Tukaram. So who is this Jnanadev? He is Jnaneshwara Mauli. Mauli in Marathi means mother. And he attained that status of mother even when he was not even reached his teens. He lived only for 21 years. Only 21 years. And at the age of 21, he took Sanjeevani Samadhi. And before he completed his 21 years, he composed or wrote commentary on Bhagavad Gita, which we are taking on Thursdays, the Bhavartha Deepika. Then he wrote the Hari part. You must have heard the Hari part. That is for the common man. Jnaneshwari, the Bhavartha Deepika, the commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, he wrote for the Pandits, the Shastris, the educated ones, the intellectual ones. And then Amrut Anubhav and Changdev Pasashti, he wrote for the seekers. For the seekers. And in this way, he took care of the common man who didn't have, who is very simple in his thinking. So for him, through poetry, through abhangas, through haripat, they are all compositions, couplets. And you can sing them, and that was enough. And today, some of you may have heard about it, there is a Varkari Sampradaya. Varkari Sampradaya, they move around Andhra Pradesh, Central India, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat. They all come and come together. They start from their villages. And streams become rivulets, rivulets become, larger rivulets, and eventually they join the rivers, and then many rivers join the ocean, isn't it? Exactly the same way. from every village, these people, they start, maybe one village, five people, another village, five, and they come together. What are they chanting? This is what they're chanting. Jnaneshwara Mauli, Jnanadev Tukaram, Jai Hari Vitthala, Shri Hari Vitthala. And there is music, there is drums, and they sleep together, they eat together, they cook as they go along, people feed them, and they live in tents, and it's a huge, huge, huge caravan. But there, in that Varkari Sampradaya, there is no rich, there is no poor, there is no intelligent, there is no ignorant, there is no Brahmin, there is no Shudra. Everyone is equal. Even the young and the old, they are also equal, because nobody goes there thinking that they are the body. They go there thinking they are devotees of the Lord. And therefore, every morning, or as the groups meet, converge into each other, everyone hugs each other, everyone touches each other's feet. There's no distinction. Everything merges into one. For these people, he wrote the Hari part. For the pandits, he wrote the, as I told you, Bhavartha Deepika. For the sincere seekers who have purified their antakaran, meaning they have purified their inner equipment, which consists of mind, intellect, memory, and ego. For them, this text of Changdev Pasashti or the text of Amrit Anubhav was given. So who is this Jnaneshwar Maharaj? It said in the village of Alandi, there was one Shri Vitthalapant. And this Shri Vitthalapant, in those days, the parents used to get the children married without their consent. Sometimes from childhood, from the birth, they were married. So somehow he finds himself married to his wife, but he is absolutely a renunciate. So immediately after marriage, he leaves home and he goes to Varanasi. He goes to in Uttar Pradesh. And there he gets initiated by the teacher, Guru Maharaj, and does his sadhana. And he's living there. And one day, his teacher, Ramanand, who was the head of the pontiff of that ashram, he decides to take the Ganga water from the Ganges in Varanasi. It's a great occasion, or it's a great tapas, to take that water and bathe the Rameshwara Ling in the south. So he decides that, and he starts moving, takes the water with some disciples, and they start to, and only walking or bullock cart, whatever it was. And they start moving, and all along the way, satsangs are going on, blessing is going on. Everyone came to know Ramanand Swami. He must have been a great personality. And when he reached Alandi, he was sitting under the banyan tree in the morning. And at that time, this Vitthalapant, his estranged wife, who was still living in Alandi, she came and touched the feet of this Ramananji, Swami Ramananji. And Ramananji said, Putravati Bhava, may you be blessed with children. She stood up and she wouldn't leave. The teacher, the Guru Maharaj, he was mesmerized. He said, why is she not leaving? What else do you want, my child? She says, please take your blessings back. He said, why, what happened? Don't you want children? Or do you already have enough children? She says, no, your blessings will never fructify, because immediately after marriage, my husband left me. And where he has gone, I got no idea. And there is no question. So many years have passed, he has not come back. So if he doesn't come back, how will I have children? So please take your blessings back. Immediately that great master closed his eyes, and Siddhi, he has the power. He checked out, where is this fellow? And he found out that he was the manager in his ashram only. Manager, sadhak, he had been there for 7-9 years in his ashram. So instead of continuing the journey to Rameshwar, immediately that great master turned back towards Varanasi, went back to the ashram and told Sri Vitthal Pant that you go back now. He said, but I have taken renunciation. I said, this is Guru Adesh. You may have taken sannyas. And he had, once the Guru said that it is Guru Adesh, then there is no question. You know you are taken care of in whatever manner. So, once we went somewhere and one Mahatma was there, one young fellow, one brahmachari, and people had given him some dakshina, and he came to this place, Kumbh Mela, and he wanted to give dakshina, because people have given him, please give it to various sadhus, you know, there are so many sadhus coming, this, that, everything. So he asked his Guru Maharaj, Swami, I want to give this dakshina to someone, whom should I give? He says, I'll tell you, which one is the good one to go, give it to. And at that time, one person was going to one of their ashram people, or that group people, one person was to be initiated into sannyas. So he said, oh, you have that money? You spend that money to buy the clothes, buy the lungil, buy the kurta, get the haircut done for this fellow, arrange the pujari, arrange the, the ingredients required for the puja. There will be expense. No, but I want to spend the money on some good Mahatmas and some ashrams. I don't want to spend money on this. See where the mind of the student is. But the moment teacher said, so is this a bad event for which you are going to spend the money? The moment his attention was brought to the right purpose, question is over. No more doubts. If that surrender is there towards the teacher, then there is no doubt whatsoever. And similarly, this Vitthal Pant, the moment his teacher said, this is Guru Upadesh, Guru Adesh, go. And then you have to face whatever consequences. Then there's no question. The strength to face the consequences comes from the conviction that whatever Guru Maharaj has told me must be true. So he comes back and he starts living with his wife. In those times, and even nowadays, in the villages and other places, or those who are very orthodox people, because they do not understand the meaning of sannyas, they feel that sannyas means sannyas or renunciation of home. Yes, it means renunciation of home, but in what manner? In what manner? Your attachment to home, that has to be severed. Your attachment to parents, your attachment to children, your attachment to wife or husband, your possessions, your body, those attachments have to be severed. That is called, and it happens, that is called sannyas. But in those days, because the vision is very gross, so they felt that he has renounced and he has come back, this is a sin. And therefore, they threw him and his wife out of the village. And as time went by, they had 4 children. Who were they? Nivrittinath, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Sopandev, and Muktabai. Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. First one was Mahesh. Second, Jnaneshwar Nivrittinath was the incarnation of Lord Shiva. Jnaneshwar Maharaj is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu. Sopandev is incarnation, they say, is Brahmaji, and Muktabai is the Shakti. See? So all these four were born. And as time went by, it became very difficult for them to sustain themselves. Somehow they managed, in spite of all the learning, in spite of all the sadhana that he has given, probably, and the blessings of his teacher, gave him the strength to withstand the ridicule of the society. And they managed in a small hut away from the village. And as the kids grew up, the urge, because he was a Brahmin, because he was an educated fellow, he said, my children must get the Yajnapavit Sanskar, they must get the initiated into the Gayatri Mantra. So he went and asked the pandits of the Alandi that, I want to do to initiate my boys and my children into the Gayatri Mantra, please allow that. Immediately they said, up, you are bahishkrit, means you don't fall under the category of Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. You don't belong to any one of these. Therefore, and you have committed a sin. Why you don't fall into any category? Because you took sannyas. Sannyasi is neither Brahmin, nor Kshatriya, nor Vaishya, nor Shudra. No caste. And yet, having left everything, you have come back. Is that the example that you show to the people? And therefore, the society and the so-called upholders of the dharma that time, they are very strict. And they said, no. Then after few times of asking them, they said, you go to Paithan. Paithan used to be the seat of learning in those days. It is near Shirdi, where the Shirdi temple is. Further up, towards Aurangabad. So you go to Paithan, and that is where the learned council is. And if they give us a letter saying that if they allow, then we will do it. He went there. They said no. Then he says, what is the way for my children to get the initiation? They said, there is only one way, because the crime that you have committed of becoming a sannyasi and then coming back into a married, into householder's life, the punishment is a severe one. Then we will do it. What is that? You have to commit suicide. You have to give up your life, both you and your wife. They were ruthless that time, because they were very long time ago. We are talking about 1269, 1268. Huh? Because Jnaneshwar Maharaj was born in 1275. So, these two come back, husband and wife. The husband comes back and tells his wife, she said, I am ready, because she was absolutely devoted to her husband. So for the betterment of the children, just like all of you want the best for your children, they also wanting the best for their children, that once we give up our life, our children will be initiated into the Gayatri Mantra, then they can get the knowledge. They were living by the lake outside the village. At night, when these four kids were sleeping, they go in and gave up their life. And they have written a letter. This is what the council in Paithan has said. Now these four kids, as they grew up, after a year or after some time, they decide that let's go to Paithan and get initiated. For what purpose our parents have given their life, let's go and fulfill that purpose now. And so they started walking towards the Paithan. And when they reached Paithan, this whole council is sitting there, all the pandits, all the shastris, all the so-called upholders of religion, knowers of scriptures, everything was in Sanskrit. So those who could study Sanskrit? Only the Brahmins. only the Kshatriyas, and sometimes they used to allow the Vaishyas if they are rich, but not others. But these are the lower than the lowest, because they have been thrown out of the system. So these upholders of the religion and dharma, they say, they ridiculed these four kids, and they said, just because your parents have given up their life, that does not make you qualified for initiation of Gayatri Mantra. Does not make you qualified for initiation of Jnana. If the matter was finished here, these four kids were about to go. They said, no, we cannot give it. What to do? No. These four kids, as I told you, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh and Shakti, they are more matured than these fellows. So they were quietly turning away. And at that time, one of the head of the council, who was sitting on the throne sort of place, he says from up there in a condescending way, that just because your name is Jnana, Jnanadev, does not mean that you are qualified for knowledge. And at that time, there was a buffalo passing by that place, and his name was also Jnana, which Jnana means knowledge. So he says, just because that buffalo's name is Jnana, so does he have knowledge? Just like he doesn't, that buffalo's name is Jnana, but he doesn't have knowledge, you are also not having the knowledge. Can he chant the mantras? Can that buffalo, because he has the name Jnana, can he chant the Vedas? Jnaneshwar Maharaj was quietly going away. Immediately he turned, he says, why not? It's a question of, he has been born for a purpose, see? He has been born for a purpose. That purpose comes out only when someone strikes it. The fire in the matchstick only comes when you strike it. An answer comes only when a question strikes you, is asked. And the quality of the answer also depends upon the quality, the samarpan, the surrender, the attitude with which the student is asking the question, isn't it? Directly proportional to that is the answer. So is the flame inherent within the stones? Yes, but they have to strike together. Only then the flame will come out. Exactly the same way. These fellows were going away quietly. But when challenged, when insulted in this manner, these fellows are not insulting these four, but they are insulting the knowledge itself by speaking in this manner. Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, of course, why not? And he goes and touches the forehead of the buffalo. Some places they say he utters Om in the ear, right ear of the buffalo, and the buffalo started chanting the Agnihotra mantra, and after that he started chanting Sahanavavtu, Sahanavbhunaktu. Then he started chanting Om Sahasra Shira Shah Purusha the Purusha Suktam, and all these fellows who are sitting there, they are mesmerized. Suddenly they feel ashamed. Suddenly they come to realize that they have tickled the wrong person. They disturbed the wrong person. Suddenly, in that one instant, their ego, which was sky high, immediately touched rock bottom. And all of them come and fall at the feet of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. See? And from then onwards, after some time, Nivrittinath asks, this is all at the age of 8 and 9. Nivrittinath, the elder brother of Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he tells, he's the guru of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. he asks Jnaneshwar Maharaj that, my dear, I think it's time that you start talking about the Bhagavad Gita so that people benefit. That is why you have been born. That is your purpose of life. Why are you born? Is it ahar, nidra, maithunanja? Is it for ahar, food, nidra, sleep, maithunan to have produced kids? Is that the only purpose that you are born for? There must be a higher purpose why you are born as a human being. If it was only for these three, which majority of the people are living for, then there is no difference between the animal kingdom and human beings, if they are doing that. Then what is the purpose? There must be some higher goal for which we have been born. And that becomes available to us by the grace. It becomes available to us through a teacher. It becomes available to us through the scriptures. It becomes available to us through the grace of God. See? And lucky are those, or blessed are those, who come to know this in their childhood, or I should not say in their childhood or blessed. Blessed are those if while living as a human being, before they die, they come to know what that they are born for a higher purpose. If they are become available to that higher purpose, immediately their whole life will take a complete 180 degrees turn. Somewhere I was told 360 degrees. Means you are back to the same point. No, 180 degrees. From extrovertedness to introvertedness. So here the Guru Maharaj, till now, Jnaneshwar Maharaj has never spoken anything, never shown that he has the knowledge of the scriptures or anything like that. But here, not even to his brothers and sisters. But when the Guru Maharaj tells him, and there the commentary begins. And if we are doing the Bhavartha Deepika on Thursdays, there you will see every verse, in every verse, he tells that by the grace of my Guru, I have been able to make this, to be able to present you with this clarity. Nowhere he takes ownership. Here also it will be the same in Changdev Pasashti. And therefore, he starts giving the lectures on Bhavartha Deepika. And there, the Bhavartha Deepika is such a beautiful composition that those who are common people, those who are not educated, haven't gone to school, don't have the great intellect, but he gives such examples that what is meant gets communicated to them. And on the other hand, those who are educated in the scriptures, know the Sanskrit, to them also he is catering. And at the same time, he is able to cater to the seekers. All in one. We normally are able to do this or that. Here he is able to present it in such a way that the entire spectrum of people is able to get the benefit of the Bhagavad Gita. He had opposition, yes, initially he had opposition. How can you speak about the scriptures which are in Sanskrit in the local language? He told in Prakrit language. He says, I have to tell. So there were people who were opposing, but there were many people who were supporting also. But to such a person who has been directed by the divine will to do such a great job, even to him, nobody can do anything. Even Chinmayananji used to speak, or many other Mahatmas, when they speak, everyone feels that the what is being told is for them specifically. So word is one, sentence is one, but everyone is feeling at one meant with what is spoken, as if that is spoken only for them. this ability to invoke out of you the truth that you are, the feeling that you become one with it, that is the only a master can do it. We talk to our children, they don't listen. Same thing we keep saying again and again and again, it doesn't happen. Then how come a master says that? Because the master is established in the truth. He is not established in duality. Where there is duality, this is not possible. Where there is the vision of oneness, there alone this is possible. So this Jnaneshwar Maharaj, through the years, he spoke on what you call Bhagavad Gita and Haripat. Then when he was 15, 16 years old, that time he gave the Changdev Pasashti. And towards the end, before he took Samadhi, he wrote the teacher, his teacher, that means Nivrittinath, asked him, now I want you to write the experience of your truth. And then he came out with Amrit Anubhav. And once he wrote Amrit Anubhav, there was no purpose for him to continue living anymore. Here we are slogging away, thinking that there is so much to do in life. And here is a 21-year-old who has done so much in 21 years that even today the humanity is singing his glory. And the way he has done it, he has not just said it, he has presented in beautiful poetry, he has said it in, and that poetry is having so much of feeling. You take the verses, and not only that, there is poetry, there is feelings in that in those verses, and the topic that those verses are talking about in Bhagavad Gita, in Changdev Pasashti, in Amrit Anubhav, is about the Paramatma, is about that truth, is about that indivisible reality. How to bring these three together, the words, the feelings, the bhav, and the truth, all into one. It cannot be a product of a human being. It has to be divine grace. See? And that was accomplished by, and with so much, by Jnaneshwar Maharaj, and it was presented with so much compassion and love. And the language tells us when we read the Bhagavad Gita by Jnaneshwar Maharaj, that how much he's cajoling us, how much he's holding your hand and asking you, look at this way, like a mother does. And therefore his name became Jnaneshwara Mauli. And at the age of 21, in 1296, he was 21 years old, and he came to a conclusion that his purpose has been completed, and he went into meditation and they closed the cave in front of him. He's still alive today. When he was 700 years old, the 700th anniversary, well, I should go back. When he was 300 years old, or his 300th anniversary, at that time, that means 300 years after, which will be 1596 or 1400, around that time, Eknath Maharaj came. And Eknath Maharaj, after birth, he was a great saint. He traveled all over India. All the way to Iran he went. Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan. Traveled very widely. You can listen to his sayings in the Guru Granth Sahib. His sayings are there. This Eknath Maharaj had taken Jnaneshwar Maharaj to be his guru mentally, and he just totally surrendered to him and his teachings. And one day in his dream, he's revealed where Jnaneshwar Maharaj is buried, and Jnaneshwar Maharaj speaking to him that, hey, Eknath, please come and help me because the root of the tree is strangling me. And he goes to that place, digs the place out along with some other people, and he finds Jnaneshwar Maharaj there. And when he finds that, he is elated. He says, wow, I found my guru. He says, I'll declare it to the whole world. Everyone knows that my guru is Jnaneshwar, but now I got you in flesh. And Jnaneshwar Maharaj is there, just like he went in, he was still there. Just like a tortoise goes into hibernation, frog goes into hibernation, when he comes back, when the summer comes, he's still the same, like that. So he says, I'm going to build a temple, I'm going to build a monument and etc. He says, don't declare to the world, I'll get disturbed. But eventually he extracts the promise, and today's temple in Alandi is built on top of where Jnaneshwar Maharaj is sitting. About 20 feet or 15 feet above the ground is the place where you are walking. And if you go dig deep inside, he is there. So that is one historical fact, that Jnaneshwar Maharaj is still there. The second, this is not a fact, this is my experience, that when we were studying with Swamiji Anubhavananji during the Vedanta studies, in 1996 was the 700th anniversary of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. And Swamiji took us to Alandi on that day. and everyone knows Swamiji there, so we had the VIP darshan of the Samadhi. And we were guests of Satarkar Maharaj. Satarkar Maharaj is a great kathakar. Sometime listen to him. And whole night we are singing this, Jnaneshwara Mauli, Jnana Devatukar, and all the musicians, they stand with those big, kya bolte unko, chan, cymbals, with cymbals, and they dance and then they bang, and it reaches a crescendo. So today, 1996, so 2016, so now it is 2018. So it's 718 years, he's still there. He's still the beacon, guiding so many seekers. When Jnaneshwar Maharaj, so this is the story of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. He's the one who has written this Changdev Pasashti. So why did this Changdev Pasashti come about? There, in those times, here, because I can't remember the names, there was a person, Changdev Maharaj was born on the banks of the river Tapti in a village called Narayana Doh. And that was a very pure place, and his father's name was Sri Mudhopant, and he was a great scholar, who Changdev Maharaj's father, and he was a great devotee of the Lord. And when this child was born, that is Changdev Maharaj, when he was born, he was so beautiful that he named him Changdev. Chang means good, beautiful, sabhya, cultured, in all beauty in all different ways. And Dev, effulgent. Because that's the feeling that came out of the father by looking at his newly born son. And as a result, and this child, by the time he was 15, he had mastered the language, He has mastered the studies. He has mastered the 14, what is that? He has mastered the Vedas, the Vedanga, the Shad Darshan, that is the 6 different philosophies, that is Nyaya Shastra and nihilistic philosophy, the Kshanik, and different 6 darshans are there. And the 18 Puranas, the 14 Vidyas, and the 64 knowledges, all this he did within 15 years. So he was a bit one up from Jnandev Maharaj. But how many years ago did he do that? 1400 years before Jnaneshwar was born. He was that smart. He was that adept. A sharp intellect and the hunger and curiosity to learn and know. Even though he knew all this, just like Narad Muniji, he also is a master of 64 Vidyas. But he was feeling the emptiness inside his heart. So one day he was sulking within himself and thinking, why I am not feeling happy, content? I know everything about this creation. Is knowing everything about the creation equal to realization? Is it? No. So where are these 64 knowledges? These 64 knowledges are about what? They are only thought knowledges, isn't it? They are only in the Prakriti. So this emptiness was just like there was this emptiness, and then his elder brothers, Sanat Kumaras, they come and guide him and they tell Narad Muni, have you fallen in love? Have you had a heartbreak? Then he says, what do you mean? What is love? He says, chant Narayana mantra, you will find out what love is. So similarly, this Changdev Maharaj, he, even though he has mastered at this young age all the knowledges, he is feeling empty inside. He is not feeling complete. He says, there is something more. Why am I not feeling content? And as a result, he goes to Varanasi. And Varanasi, he goes to Kashi. And there, while he goes there, he comes to know about a great yogi who was living in a cave away from the Kashi Kshetra itself, and very difficult to reach. And somehow, without food, without support, without any help, he reaches there and tells that yogi Maharaj that I want to get rid of this uneasiness which is within my bosom. Why you come to these classes is only because you want to get rid of this incompleteness, of this emptiness, of this uneasiness. And on the other hand, you enjoy. So when you enjoy listening, Shravanam, when you enjoy this topic, for that period of moment, all the itch to get involved in the world. Involvement in the world only creates even more itch for the world, meaning desire for the world. But when you are coming here to any satsang, or you are singing your bhajan, or doing your dhyan, or doing when your attention is on something higher, at that time we find that we become settled, isn't it? And that's exactly what our Yogi Raj also wants. Our Changdev also wants. So he asked this, and that Yogi Raj was not an easy fellow to be pleased. He will not teach to anyone who comes to him. But when he saw the dedication, the commitment, and the eagerness to the cause of Yoga Abhyas, he takes him under his wings. And he gave him the initiation. Then this Changdev Maharaj lived with his teacher, for this Yogiraj, for 7 years, and because he was already a very smart student, you remember, by age 15 he has learned everything, entire gamut of scriptures. Within 7 years he masters every aspect of the yoga abhyas, pranayam, sanyam, savikalpa samadhi, nirvikalpa samadhi, everything. And we only know these eight, yama, niyama, asana, pranayam, pratyahara, dharana, dhyan, samadhi. But within these, there are many, many things more. As you keep diving deep into it, many things get revealed. Siddhis come as we go into sanyam, savikalpa samadhi and nirvikalpa samadhi. So he has mastered it to the T. And the teacher taught him laya samadhi. Laya samadhi means what? Laya means absorption. So he was able to absorb himself into his own source. You can, just like you get absorbed into the sleep, right? You understand this much? You can get absorbed into your own source, that is also a samadhi. You can absorb the five elements, like in Bhagavatam we were doing 2 weeks ago, that the earth element is absorbed into the water element, water into fire, fire into air, air into the space, space into the tamasik ahankar into the avyakta, and avyakta into Ishvara. That is the step by step. Kundalini is step by step. Muladhar is absorbed into the Swadhisthan into Manipur, Manipur into Anahat, Anahat into Vishuddha, Vishuddha into Jnana, and Jnana into Sahasrar. This is step by step. Laya Prakriya. Laya means absorption. There are many different ways you can do it. Like in our Bhagavat, if you one of the examples is the flute, and you take the flute and you keep thinking about that the Lord is pushing the air through the flute, and I am that flute with the seven holes, and you keep thinking about it, you will vanish. This is also laya prakriya. When you chant bhajans and you get absorbed, that is also laya prakriya. Kriya yoga, that is also laya prakriya. See? So there are different ways, but one drawback is here. And what is that? That when you get absorbed and when you come out of absorption, the world is still there. That is the problem. To come out of the absorption and still see the world as it was before means you have not merged completely. You have not got absorbed completely. There is still error in your absorption. It is happening at a matter level, but it has not touched the Paramatma. You have not become absorbed into the Paramatma. You can speak the language, you can talk, you can explain, you can guide, but you have not absorbed. You have not become one with the Paramatma. Becoming one with Paramatma means to be the Paramatma. Such a person is called a sage. Such a person is called a living sage. We are not, see? So this Changdev Maharaj, here it says that he practiced this laya samadhi and he gained great peace within his bosom. Everyone's mind is fluttering all the time. And through this Laya Samadhi, he attained great peace and tranquility. But that peace and tranquility was not the final one, was not the transcendental one. But having experienced that and going deeper and deeper into it, the delusion with regards to the Atma, that this Atma is the same Atma everywhere. This Atma is all that there is. So what is the nature of the self? That had not clicked. So you get infinite peace and bliss when you go to sleep also, isn't it? You can get it in coma also. You can get it in meditation also. You can get it through japa also. But is that equal to realization? Is that equal to Atma Sakshatkar, coming to know direct experience of the truth, direct experience of the self? Is that equal to that? This had not happened with Changdev Maharaj. But because of the yoga sadhana that he has practiced, he has... by the Guru Agya, that Yogi Raj, who was his teacher, he told him that now you go and you teach everyone along the Tapti River. And he kept, as he went southwards, he spoke about and he did the Tirth Yatra, and all the people who came along the way, he taught them whatever he had learned, to whatever extent they could learn. And he kept moving. And eventually, and based upon the techniques that he had learned from his teacher and the siddhis that he had gained, he was, every 100 years, he was again able to become young and continue his life. And like this, he had done 14 times. There are, even today, there are people who can do that. Maybe not to the extent that I have not, the one whom I have come across, or I have read, one I have come across, and one I have read about, or I have, but Swamiji has met him, Devra Baba. He was 500 years old. And the one I'm talking about is Barfani Baba, whom I have seen. He's 350 years old, 10 years ago. 356 or 52 or something. So there are people like that. It's nothing. In Kali Yuga, why it is not pop? It's, oh my God, 350. It's a figment of imagination. How can you prove it? Either you believe or you don't. But these things are possible.
Does he look young or old?
When I met him, he was in his 50s, 60s. But what he does is, when he reaches 60, 65, sometime, then he goes on a 20-year treatment for himself. Becomes young, 16 years old. The whole body metamorphosizes at a cellular level, through diet, through concentration, through meditation, through certain whatever. They don't tell us that, but there is a particular that is called the kayakalpa technique in yoga. It's not easy to do. It requires tremendous discipline. And as a result of that, he becomes 16, then continues living again for 40 years. So just like this Barfani Baba, now he's lived 350 years. Imagine how many generations people have known him. Naturally, the crowd that will follow him will be quite huge compared to here. So imagine 1400 years he has lived. He knows your great, 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 14, every century, four generations. 14 times four, imagine. That many generations he knows. people have known him, people have come and gone, but he is the substratum in the society. And as a result, he became very popular. And because of his siddhis, he had mastered the five elements, he had mastered all the sentient beings, Vashikaran Shakti. Vashikaran means mastery over all living beings. So even those animals who were enemies of each other were friendly in his presence. Just like in the presence of light, there is no darkness. In his presence, everyone was friendly, everyone was lived happily, including animals. But as a result of this, he had a bit of an ego. Bit, maybe. That I have lived for 1400 years. That so many people follow me. That even animals are, are not ferocious towards each other in my presence. It can get into your head when you say something, let the child be born, and it happens. Once it's okay, you may have a doubt that it was me. No, it was the Lord. Bhagavan, aapki wajah se ho gaya. The word were yours, but the power was his, and you surrender. But after 1400 years and blessing everyone, it goes into your head, man, maybe I am the one. See? And as he is living in this glory about himself, all people coming to him and singing his glory, and he has got disciples and students all over who have learned from him, and they go around, and slowly, as the time went by, 12, what was that year? Somewhere 1290, 1285 came, and the information about Jnaneshwar Maharaj started falling on his ears. And people started saying that he is a great yogi, he is even younger than you, and he is able to do so many things. And the stories were that Jnaneshwar Maharaj, one day people came into the house of Jnaneshwar when parents have gone away, and they were cooking. Someone came and took the hot plate. It used to be made out of earthenware, and they came and broke it because animosity towards the kids. And the sister was cooking the chapatis and puran poli, and she said, "But Dada, I don't have how do I cook and how do I feed you? I am also, what do I do?" And she's crying. And that time this fellow comes, he says, "Don't you worry, food will be made. You make, roll your chapatis. But how will I cook it?" He immediately bends down, he says, "You cook it on my back." And he hits up his back, and those who have broken the earthen hot plate, they watch. Oi, this fellow is not an ordinary one. And the news spread like wildfire that this young fellow, 8-9 years old, is able to heat up his back, and the mother and his daughter, sister is cooking puran poli on it. Chapati. Then another story was there, and that is that Sachidananda Maharaj. Sachidananda Maharaj was, when Jnaneshwar Maharaj used to give commentary on the Gita called Bhavartha Deepika, Jnaneshwari, he used to write notes. So he had done quite a bit work, and then Jnaneshwar Maharaj had to edit, and one day he passed away. And for whatever the reasons came, Jnaneshwar Maharaj came and made that dead man alive. Made that dead man alive. Sri Sachidananda Maharaj. He was also a sannyasi, I think so. But he makes him alive. So this news has also spread like a wildfire, and it has reached, what? I can control elements. I can control living beings. But he is making a dead man alive. After 1400 years of sadhana, just like Ramakrishna Paramahans, one yogi came across, all the people were sitting in Belur Mat, sitting in front of Ramakrishna Paramahans. Satsang was going on. It's open. You can see the river flowing next to you. They're sitting there and they're enjoying, just being with someone is singing, some question answers going on. And suddenly someone says, hey, look. Everyone looks out there. What is there? One person is walking on water and crossing the river. Immediately, Ramakrishna Paramahans becomes secondary. That fellow who's walking over becomes primary. Miracles are sought after by human beings. Who are these? The ignorant ones. They want miracles. So they all leave Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna, who cares if there is or there is not? Like some of you are asking. The first question they ask after coming to this place is not, Swamiji, I am just waiting for the text. No. The first question is, how many people are coming, Swamiji? Are you come here for people or have you come here for your own growth? Where is your attention? And you know very well, it does not matter to me if it is one person or 10 people or 100, it has never happened. But it does not matter to me. But question is, where is your attention? Is it on people? Is it on crowd that we are able to attract? Or is it about your becoming available to this beautiful text? To become available and transform without knowing that transformation has taken place. But if before the text has even started, you are thinking about the bedroom, about the number of people, and about whether food is there or not there, then you have lost the plot, frankly. This is what the state of those people was. Ramakrishna Paramahans did not make any difference. He kept sitting there. All these people went to the banks of the river to welcome that great yogi who is walking over the waters. He came. And why did he come? He wanted to have darshan of Ramakrishna Paramahans, who has never walked on water. And he comes. And all of them are following. Swami, you know, he walked over the water. Did you see him? Oh my God, how did he do it? Why did he do it? What power, what exercise you have to do? What yoga abhyas you have to do? This, that. Yeah. Which petrol station has the cheapest petrol price? Today's example. This one or that one or this one? Who cares? Where is our attention? Their attention was on the miracle. Ramakrishna Paramahans is sitting there. He asks one question. After some time, all these people, they have to release all this pent-up energy in them. And then he asks, how many years sadhana did you do, O Yogi Maharaj? He said, 22 years I have done sadhana, and now today I was able to walk, or today or whenever, I was able, after 22 years I was able to walk over the water and cross the river. Ramakrishna Paramahans said, I pay 20 paisa and cross the river. I pay 20 paisa and cross the river. And you spent 22 years, I paid 22 paisa. And you spent 22 years just to gain one siddhi. Changdev Maharaj has spent 1400 years, yet he has not come to know the nature, the true nature of the truth, of the self. So this Changdev Maharaj, when he comes to hear of this, and the news is coming, before it was just tidbits, then it became a stream, then it became rivers. Now everyone is talking about Jnaneshwar Maharaj. So an urge in him arises that I must meet this fellow. Who is this? Who has made a dead man alive? I have not been able to do that. I have a control over the five elements, I have control over the sentient beings, but I don't have control over death. Yes, I can keep living, I can keep extending my life. If that is called control, yes, I have got control. But I don't know how to make a dead man alive. And remember, he is already proficient in all Vedas and Vedanta, Changdev Maharaj. But as he practiced his yoga and got siddhis and everything, that knowledge went in the backroom cupboard somewhere. And this mysticism became more important. And now his conundrum is that he wants, the urge is in his heart that I want to meet this Jnaneshwar Maharaj. So he says, hey, get me a piece of paper, I want to write him a letter. Gets a piece of letter and sits down and starts, wants to write a letter. When he starts, picks up the pen, he says, should I write, kya kehte hain? Should I write Chiranjeev? Chiranjeev means to a younger person you'd call a Chiranjeev, because he's only 15 years old. But knowledge-wise, he's much more. He says, no. I can't show him that I am big. No, I can't say Chiranjeev to him. Then, do I say, dear sir, or give him exalted position? But then in age, he is younger to me. How can I call him like that? And in this conundrum, he is unable to come to a conclusion. And in that inconclusive state of mind, he sends a blank piece of paper through one of his disciples to Jnandev Maharaj. After 1400 years of living, having all the knowledge, he is not able to come to a conclusion what to write to a 15-year-old boy. And when Jnaneshwar Maharaj receives the letter, Muktabai, she was a young girl, she was 8, 9, 10 years old. She looks at, it's a blank letter. Changdev Maharaj is also blank. He also, you can take it two ways. Either he is blank or he is empty. He doesn't know what to write. Jnandev Maharaj says, no. Mukta, think properly. If he has sent me a blank letter, it means he is empty. He can be filled up. He can be filled up. If the cup is full, you cannot fill it up. So, wise people always look at the positive. And then taking those empty pieces of paper, Jnaneshwar Maharaj writes him a letter, which is the 65 verses. And in through these 65 verses, Jnaneshwar Maharaj completely understands where Changdev Maharaj is coming from. It is his ego. That how can I bow down to him? Or how can I call him Chiranjeev? The confusion that is going on in his head, he can clearly understand. And therefore, addressing him. And how does he address him? He does not address him saying that, great yogi, this, that. He says, we will see when the text begins. Here, the first verse itself says, Swasti Shri Vateshu. Vateshu is Lord Shiva. He says, blessings be to the Lord Shiva. So you are not other than Lord Shiva. You are the child of Lord Shiva because you have lived for 1400 years. So 2-3 places he takes different names for him. Our speech should be such that it invokes the Paramatma within us. Our speech should be such that it shifts our attention from the world to the essence. And all these 65 verses, as we go through them, you will see every word, every OV. The OVs, normally we say verses, shlokas. In Jnaneshwar Maharaj's language, Prakrit language, it is called OVs. OV. Each one of them is taking us, shifting our attention to our essential nature. And with this, he is saying that just like when I look at the mirror, whom do I see in the mirror? When I look into the mirror, whom do I see? I see myself. When we meet, he's calling him. He says, when we meet, let the meeting be of this manner, that self is meeting the self. That self is seeing the self. And for that, what shift Changdev Maharaj needs to bring about in his mind, in his disposition, is in these 65 verses. And some verses are there that Jnaneshwar Maharaj is also saying that because of my Guru Maharaj, I am able to answer this and all that. So, and he tells Changdev Maharaj that you sent me a blank letter, and I am also blank. You also sent a blank letter. So we are really the same. I also don't want to say anything. But my love for the self is so great. My love for you as the self is so great that when I looked at the blank paper, I was transported into myself. Because when in the mind there are no thoughts, what happens? And you are conscious. You are the self. He says, when I looked at the blank paper, there's nothing to communicate with. So I fell back into the self. But from the self, this furuna, this inspiration is coming that whatever I am feeling, I cannot stop myself from putting it on the paper. And I am eagerly looking forward to meet you. But let that meeting not be in duality. Let that meeting be in unity of experience. And with this preamble, tomorrow morning we'll begin the Changdev Pasashti. From the first verse itself, you will be transported. And in this way, Changdev Maharaj comes. The story continues. Changdev Maharaj comes, falls, and then eventually Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, I am not your guru. What happens is, Changdev Maharaj comes with his whole zing bang gang, with all the devotees, all the disciples, thousands of them, with all the animals also following him. And when they come to Jnaneshwar Maharaj, someone comes and tells these four brothers and sisters, they are sitting on a wall. That wall is still there in Alandi. They are sitting on the wall and brushing their teeth. And someone comes, hey, Changdev Baba, Changdev is coming, Changdev is coming. So Mukta Bhai tells Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Dada, we should not make an elderly person to come to youngsters. We should welcome him before he reaches here. Chalna. So the moment he says, when she requests him like that, he makes the wall fly. And all these four are sitting on that. See this? He makes them fly. Wall, an inert object. He makes it fly to welcome and reaches outside the outskirts of Alandi to welcome him. When Changdev Maharaj, and what is he riding? He is riding on a tiger, and his what do you call, chabukko ka whip is the snake, and he is coming with trishul in his hand. He is like a god, and with because he is he's the overlord of the elements, the effulgence is fantastic, awesome. But when he sees that from far away, that there is something coming in the sky, and eventually sees these four brothers, and the stone wall is flying and landing in front of him, immediately he, see, this is the greatness of masters. Immediately he gets down from the tiger and goes and falls at the feet of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. Immediately. Without should I not. That should I not was when he was writing the letter. But now, the conclusion that has come into his mind is, I am the overlord of the sentient beings and the five elements. But he is able to move. He can make an inert matter sentient. His power is much more. He can make a dead man alive. His power is much more. He must be here. That emptiness that was still there again returns. That discontentment which was there, it needs to be filled up. That emptiness because of which he was unable to write the right words in order to ask for an audience or meet Jnaneshwar Maharaj. All that needs to be filled up with the right information or right knowledge. Not information, knowledge. And that knowledge is always present. But he was not able to recognize it by his attention is on the emptiness. His attention is on the emptiness. His attention is on what words I must write. If my attention is on what words I must speak, I will not be able to speak because I don't know what to speak. See? So when he falls at the feet of Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Jnaneshwar Maharaj accepts him, but he says, I am not your guru. He says, but I came from so far, I accept you as my guru. You may accept, but I am not your guru. That is the greatness of a Guru Maharaj. Just like Matanga Muni, when Vishwamitra goes to him and says, what is Brahman? He said, you are that. He says, I am not your guru. Go to Dattatreya Maharaj. That wisdom to know, like our Nisargadat Maharaj, if someone said to Nisargadat, Swamiji, what is past karma, what is future karma, what is prarabdha karma, should we do karma or not, can we get rid of karma, can we come to know the truth from karma, but what about our duties, this, that, he says, this is not available in my shop, go to some other shop, get out of this place. Straightforward. There's no, oh, what will happen if I send him, then my group will become small. No, that type of thought. He is doing him a service. Attention is not how many people. Attention is not on anything, but his attention is on the truth. Is this fellow who is asking about karma, is he going to be able to answer that question? Can Nisargadat Maharaj come down from the experience of that I am that disposition to the body identification where karma is done? Not possible. And therefore he says, go to some other shop. It's not available in this shop. Because he was a shopkeeper. Similarly, Jnaneshwar Maharaj also says that I am not your guru. Then who is your guru? Muktabai. His younger sister, youngest sister, becomes the guru of this 1400-year-old sadhu. Why? Because he was still body identified. He still had a personality. He was not able to recognize. And one day, the story goes, I'll conclude with that. One day the story goes that this young girl is taking bath and she says, hey, Changdev, get me something. And he comes and he closes his eyes. Or he's looking that way and giving her some towel or whatever. She says, you're still a uncooked pot. You're not ripe yet. He says, why? 1400 years. She says, I am a young girl. And you are afraid to look at a young girl? That some bad thoughts will come in your mind? I have to work on you a lot. After 1400 years, you are still worried about man and woman. You are still worried about male and female. After 1400 years. She says, I have to do a lot of work with you, my dear. So, but this Changdev Pasashti, these 65 verses, is the love letter. Love is always unconditional. And this unconditional love which has become invoked in the heart of Jnaneshwar Maharaj because of that blank letter. Because of that blank letter from Changdev. And he's not able to contain the state that he's transported to. That inspiration makes him write these 65 verses. And now, when he's writing, naturally there is, for a general person, he wants to meet Changdev Maharaj, but he doesn't want to meet Changdev Maharaj as a person. He wants to meet him as the self. He wants to meet, and the example given here is, just like a person sees himself in the mirror and sees himself, he says, I want you to come and meet you as the self. How is that possible? What is the technique? What are the contemplations? What are the meditations? What is the, and the whole thing. That will begin in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.